en minoría los que cruzaron mares, desiertos y montañas, muchas adversidades. Le dicen minorías, aquí son mayoría, el sueño americano, la ruina de sus vidas. Yo no sé por qué la vida fue tan cruel, porque allí dejó todo su corazón, su amor. Su amor, mi amor, le dicen minoría los que cruzaron mares, desiertos y montañas, muchas adversidades. Le dicen minorías, aquí son mayoría, el sueño americano, la ruina de sus vidas. Policía mata, ey, el coyote canta, ey, la maldad espera y escondida por la vía del tren. Dime tú, ¿y ahora qué? ¿Dónde no vamos a esconder? Donde quiera que yo vaya, todo me quieren joder. El gobierno mata, ey, la migra te atrapa, ey, que se quema la candela y miro nada con su ley. Dime tú, ¿y ahora qué? ¿Dónde no vamos a meter? Babilonia persiguiendo mientras yo me echo a correr. La familia llora, ey, no lo encuentran en el ley, nunca lo vuelven a ver.
Among the 35,000 museums across the United States, there is only one museum that tells our story, and only one museum that elevates the Arab American voice and inspires the generations of today and the generations to follow. A thoughtful narrator of history, a passionate advocate of justice, and an innovative expression of our identity, the Arab American National Museum has served as the heart of Arab American storytelling, making its mark in the world of art, science, and culture. Brought to life by Access in 2005, the creation of this crown jewel and Smithsonian affiliate was guided by Access's vision of a just and equitable society that includes the full story and contributions of Arab Americans. Emerging as a powerful reclamation of our narrative in a space that has been dominated by ignorance and misconceptions that have threatened our cultures, traditions, and truths, the Arab American National Museum preserves our story and shares our contributions with the world. Locally and across our nation, we offer a history created by you to sustain a future that will be built by you. Since the very beginning of time, storytelling has been a way for us to navigate and discover our world. It is what heals us, unites us, and inspires us. Whether it is stories, songs, paintings, photographs, films, textbooks, novels, or poetry, the beauty and contributions of our unique and remarkable community are captured through the history and art that live on in our treasured Arab American National Museum.
Welcome and thank you for tuning in to the annual Concert of Colors Forum on Community, Culture, and Race. My name is Jumana Salami and I am the Deputy Director at the Arab American National Museum in Dearborn, Michigan. For our blind and low vision guests, my hair falls slightly below my chin to my collarbone. I'm wearing a black shirt with a floral pattern and I have brown eyes. Before we begin this evening's program, I'd like to take a couple minutes to ground us with our land acknowledgement statement. The Arab American National Museum sits on Anishinaabe land and resides within the region with the highest concentration of Arab Americans in the nation. We also acknowledge our neighboring city, Detroit, as Anishinaabe territory and other indigenous peoples' land as being the largest majority black city in the nation with a long legacy of African diasporic contributions. Together, we also uplift and honor the indigenous and diasporic communities from wherever you may be tuning in from today. I also wanted to thank our museum members and supporters. Your continued support helps us to continue delivering content and programming. To make a donation, learn about our upcoming programs, or to become a museum member, please visit arabamericanmuseum.org. We would also like to thank all of the sponsors who have made this program possible today. Today's program is produced by the Arab American National Museum and presented in partnership with Detroit Public Television, the Kaiga Foundation, and Culture Source. Since the inception, the forum has signified a collective power and hope. Together, we have shared our desire for change, our fight for human rights, and a promise for a better tomorrow. We hope that tonight's program will continue to create space for meaningful conversation and inspire change. Tonight's program, which is part of the 29th Annual Concert of Colors, will focus on the theme, What is Democracy? The Artist Responds. We will begin with an uplifting keynote address, followed by a discussion featuring an amazing lineup of artists. I am so excited to introduce tonight's keynote speaker, Kristina Wong. Kristina Wong is a performance artist, comedian, writer, who has presented across North America, the UK, and Hong Kong. Her most notable touring show, Wong Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, looks at the highest rates of depression and suicide among Asian American women. Her work has been awarded with grants from Creative Capital, the MAP Fund, the Center of Cultural Innovation, the Defree Foundation, the National Performance Network, 6 Artists in Residency grants, and a COLA Master Arts Fellowship from the Los Angeles Department of Cultural Affairs. She is currently touring with the Wong Street Journal, which navigates white privilege as an Asian American Majangu in East Africa. Her newest show is titled Kristina Wong for Public Office and is a campaign-style comedic performance that will leave guests questioning the present state of politics and campaign methods. Please join us in welcoming Kristina Wong.
Arab American National Museum in Dearborn, Michigan. Concert of Colors Forum of Community, Culture, and Race streaming across the world. Are you ready to rally? I can't hear you. No, really, I can't hear you. This is a streaming event that was pre-recorded. I said, are you ready to throw blind fanatical support around a candidate who makes promises and maybe delivers on a fraction of them? Are you ready to throw all your hopes and dreams onto what I will convince you that I am? Then please give it up for your favorite and forever public servant, Kristina Wong! Hello! Hello! Hello, good to see you, hello! My fellow Americans, my constituents, my captive worshipers. I am so honored to be here as your keynote speaker addressing themes of artists and democracy. And before I go any further, I want to acknowledge that I'm speaking to you today from my home in Koreatown, Los Angeles. It sits on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Gabrielino, Tongva, Chumash, and Keech peoples. Friends, some of you may know me as Kristina Wong, the wacky performance artist. Some of you have no idea who I am because I am a performance artist. What I did a few years ago was I embarked on making this performance art campaign called Kristina Wong for Public Office, where I performatively rallied for a political seat I had not even filed to run for yet. And I did things like debate a dog. It's a really cute dog, it's a poodle mix. I won both debates, BTW. I did meet and greets on Hollywood Boulevard with an actual political puppet. I even held focus groups with voters to see if they would notice when I plagiarized speaking points from political dictators throughout history. And fun fact here, most voters find Stalin to be a quirky guy with a big vision. But after years of those performative shenanigans, I come here today speaking to you all as a real-life elected official. That's right, Kristina Wong, the performance artist, actually became an elected official with no prior experience in politics. Now, I may have never grabbed someone by their genitals without their permission. I may not be able to get my whole inner circle indicted or disbarred. I may have never paid off a porn star. In fact, I may have never paid for porn, unlike some idiots. Trump! Who have no idea where you can get it for free. Pornhub, Xvideo, Xhamster, YouPorn, You jizz, triple X bunker, handjob hunter, pussy tort, slut roulette, porn rabbit, 88 gals, analyzed, stuffer DP, ape tube, metaporn, WilliamsonNoma.com! Excuse me. But despite all those shortcomings, I was able to prove to my constituents that I have what it takes to serve in public office in April 2019. It was my extreme honor to be chosen by the American people to represent them, specifically the 71 voters who I waved down in front of the Seoul International Park and Rec Center to vote for me as their sub-District 5 rep on the Wilshire Center Koreatown Neighborhood Council. These voters saw my vision for America, or they succumbed to me holding them hostage on the sidewalk, urging them with this Korean passing face, please just go into that gym, just check off my name, just please. It was like, take 2 minutes, just vote for me. I'm good, all right? I'm good. And with a total of 72 votes, if you count the vote that I cast for myself, I was elected by the people of America, specifically the people who live in the half square mile of Subdistrict 5 here in Koreatown, to represent them at our monthly meetings as an unpaid representative of the Wilshire Center Koreatown Neighborhood Council, which meets in the greatest backdrop for the legislation of American democracy that there is. The Pio Pico Library at 7th and Oxford, one block south of Ralph's, which is only second to the great institution where we've been doing our meetings for the last 15 months, Zoom. Anyway, this past April, I was reelected to my seat with 19 votes total. I ran unopposed because clearly the work I've done in my unpaid part-time political position, where I am one of 26 elected reps on a neighborhood council that's mostly advisory, but no real legislative power. And even when we make a majority vote, can't single-handedly make major shifts to even city policy, certainly not when our neighborhood is only allotted an annual budget of $32,000, cut down from $42,000, which averages to 11 cents each for 130,000 constituents. That's when it was 42,000. I don't know what 32,000 now, it's a lot less. Anyway, clearly the 19 people who reelected me recently knew I have what it takes to stop the unending bureaucracy and to do it inside the 4-hour meetings on Zoom, which we spend most of the time trying to meet quorum, make motions to amendments to agenda items that end up getting tabled. Those 19 voters knew I had what it takes to make sweeping changes to our democracy. Oh, but I'm not here to slip into a long, crazy tirade about how frustrating it's been for me to create change, even on the local level. I'm here to encourage artists to get involved in democracy, or maybe even think about running yourself. Now, I am not the first artist to run for public office. I come from a long line of artists who found great second runs as public servants. For example, actor and comedian Al Franken became the senator of Minnesota before having to step down because of sexual misconduct allegations. Not a good example. Okay. Actor and action hero Arnold Schwarzenegger became the governor of California and also the father to his housekeeper's kids. Oh, you know who got into politics after being rejected from art school? Hitler! And you know what? We are not going to get into examples just right now. Yeah, no. Instead, let me tell you an inspirational story about how I came to have the runs for public office. Now go back in time with me, if you will, to March 2016. Oh, let me take you back. It's just a few months before the November 2016 election. Obama is still president. And for all those types who are very much in an arty liberal arts bubble, me in LA, we're convinced that we will be electing a president who will be making ceiling-breaking history. Now, the self-satirizing comedian that I am, I go ahead and in the time of March 2016, I pitch a reality television show pilot to True TV. The premise of this pilot is that I am playing a character named Kristina Wong who has some sort of wacky, out of the ordinary ideas to get apathetic Americans off their couches for social justice. I'm sort of like a self-satirizing activist character. I mean, like, what could go wrong, right? It's like, we are all on the same page, right? That activists are like normal, fully fleshed people. So we can afford to, you know, lovingly make fun of ourselves and the things that we care about, right? Right? I mean, poking fun of myself as an activist wouldn't somehow be misread as an earnest representation of an activist. I mean, Americans understand nuance, don't they? It's not like the self-satirizing activist character that I'd be playing in the pilot would actually spread a stereotype that activists are naive and that this character I'd be playing in the pilot would somehow make me a liability to everything I care about, right? 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 Well, by the time we are greenlit to shoot the pilot, it's a few months after the November 2016 election, which BTW didn't really turn out the way that I expected. Now, every other week, I find myself, not as part of a TV pilot or anything else, just survival, attending a women's march or a rally in protest of a Muslim ban. I am surrounded at these rallies by millions of Americans who are grieving a country that has turned its backs on the tired, poor, huddled masses yearning to breathe free. All around me are people for whom activism is about life or death survival. And that pilot that I had pitched back when Obama was president about this wacky, tone-deaf activist who was conquering all this political apathy was literally irrelevant in a world crumbling by the tweet. My ironic, self-satirizing 2016 persona now was sounding like real-life white supremacists who aren't being funny or ironic. How is it that artists and politicians have switched jobs? They now create the shock and spectacle that have us questioning reality. We now are the ones as artists to reclaim the space for social truth and change. And when True TV inevitably passes on my pilot, I find myself asking, what do you do when you are an out-of-style performance artist and your work as an artist just isn't enough to create enough social change, and you can't get a second-tier cable network to give you your own reality television show? What do you do? You run for public office, baby! Listen, running for office, I know, it's not for everybody. I'm not saying every artist needs to stop what they're doing and run for office. I am saying that legislative change, which shifts things structurally about how things work, it happens through the people that we elect to office. So at some point, in terms of what we want to see happen, we have to make contact with politicians, or we have to make a big enough message and cultural shift that they hear this and they shift how they vote as our elected representatives. Okay, so for months, I resisted actually running for office because I didn't want to become that monster that I would make fun of in my work. So what I would do instead is I would sit on my couch and I would tweet, hashtag cancel, hashtag boycott, hashtag take it all down. And I would get retweeted and I would get liked. And sometimes the news outlets would pick up my tweets and they would run it on their news outlet website thingy. And I would feel so big and so powerful. And what I was actually doing was absolutely nothing. As it turns out, tweets aren't the same as doing the actual work of democracy. As artists, we've been told this entire pandemic that we are not essential. But I would like to say to you all that I think that a lot of the work that we do is very essential. We're able to bring communities together. We're able to create compelling human messaging. We're able to create miracles on almost no budget. And this is the kind of work that we do as artists to bring together communities that politicians cannot do. And that's what makes us so essential. Now, during the pandemic,
I found myself so frustrated at how slow local and federal government was at getting basic needs to the people who needed them the most. So even as someone who was elected and couldn't get anything done, I decided to start the Auntie Sewing Squad. I named the group before I realized that our acronym is ASS. Now, the Auntie Sewing Squad set out to sew home-sewn face masks for medical workers at the top of the pandemic because we had a PPE shortage. Now, this shifted quickly to us sewing for lots of vulnerable communities that have long since been ignored by the federal government. That's Indigenous communities, farm workers, migrants at the border, the unhoused. Now, I thought that we were just going to be like a three-week stopgap that would step in to provide masks until, you know, the government stepped in. But that never happened. Our squad has grown to 800 volunteer aunties nationwide, and we are still sewing masks right now for communities who cannot access vaccines. Now, during the pandemic, I have found ways to use my art to boost up an amazing and yet underutilized food bank in my neighborhood called the World Harvest Food Bank, where everyone can access healthy food regardless of your income status. It's the answer to eradicating hunger in LA, if people know it exists and if people use it. And our neighborhood council and our city can't seem to do that much more to promote this food bank. So, you know, being the low rent Kardashian that I am, I decided to be a food bank influencer for them. You can catch my food bank haul videos on YouTube. I'm sometimes wearing a fur coat in those videos at the food bank because I want to take the stigma out of going to the food bank and show just how fun it is to use this resource. And as a result, I am proud to say more people, not everyone in LA, but more people are using this food bank. Now that's the artist in me stepping in to fill the gaps of community building that politics will always miss.
I'm not always going to be a politician, but I am always going to be an artist. And as an artist, we are the direct action. We are the direct response. We carry stories and messages that connect us until legislation shifts. Artists, we make culture, and culture shifts public understanding, and that's what leads to changes in policymaking and how the legislation shifts. Artists make connections and tell stories and put a heart to the things that we fight for. Our democracy, not a perfect system, but it's what we have, and it works when we work it. We're powerful. We're essential. And if we're not running for office ourselves, we need to do the work to be heard by those who pull the levers of systemic change. Thank you so much for having me. Have a wonderful event tonight, and may gods of all denominations bless this United States of America!
Where our vision of forging a world where artificial boundaries disappear and the diversity and unity of humanity is celebrated. So we are aligned with the vision of Ishmael Ahmed, the award-winning founder and director of the Council of Colors, who calls and treats everyone as brother and sister. I've had the honor and pleasure to introduce to you tonight a dynamic and inspiring panel of world-class artists. We're very thankful to the Arab American National Museum for their commitment to the world of arts and justice. I'm particularly thankful to Catherine Grabowski, the curator of programs, for her outstanding vision and execution. So much has happened since 1 year ago. Let's take a moment of reflection and honor those who lost their lives during COVID-19. So many great artists and others who passed during this pandemic. Of course, we'll cover a lot of the issues that happened over the year. We'll discuss these development with spiritual-based artists. I've had the pleasure to speak with each of them and understand their role in this culture, their fact that they are an extension of a creative force, someone who envisions what doesn't exist and brings it into reality. So that's a very sacred mission. Tonight, I will pose questions to the panelists in an open format. Each panelist will respond based on their heartfelt decision, and their response would be very spontaneous. I'd like to begin with Dalia Basiouny. Dalia Basiouny is an Egyptian writer, theater maker, social activist, biofarmer, academic, and translator. Her theater work includes directing 20 plays performed in Egypt, England, the United States, Morocco, Iraq, Zimbabwe, Ethiopia, and Germany. Dalia's theater and academic work focuses on the role of women in theater, a very important role. Her PhD at SUNY Graduate Center explores the political theater of Arab American women after 9/11. She established the Bill for the Arts in Cairo in 1997, an independent group that promotes women's work and explores new ways of telling women's stories in theater and on film. She is the recipient of many awards, including the Fulbright Arts Grant, United States, the British Council of Savining Scholarship, UK, and the Theater Production Award from the Arab Fund for the Arts and Culture in 2010 for her play Solitaire. Today is particularly special. Today is Dalia's birthday. Please join me on social media in wishing her a wonderful happy birthday, for she is a divine spirit and believes in planting seeds for the future.
After 30 years, the tyrant stepped down. It was the most amazing party. 3 million people in the square, millions all over Egypt, but also millions all around the world. People who just believe in democracy and had hope followed this revolution as a sign that people who were told are in a coma and would never change took the matters in their own hand and made a difference. It was amazing to live through this day and see it with my own eyes. I went back to New York with very different feelings. You know how 9/11 kind of toppled the world topsy-turvy, so many changes, but 10 years later, the Arab Spring was this new fresh breath that was giving hope to people that we can create our own destiny. I know so many of these revolutions went in a very different direction and so much of them are bloody, and I wonder who is responsible for that, for crushing all these dreams. But I know as a people, not just Egyptians, the world is a different place now. We are a different people. I mean, some of you know or were in the marshes here in September for the climate. This is the new world that we are gonna create. You know what? I will not go and swear the oath to be an American citizen. I will keep my Egyptian passport. I will keep this passport that is written in the weird language, opens at the wrong end, and is now celebrated in all airports. And I would like for my daughter to carry it in pride.
In Tahrir Square, we were really under the attack of snipers. We had no idea what could happen next, and some horrible things happened while we were there. But there was still this defiance that was so life-affirming. I've never felt as alive or as useful or as part of a real community as being in the square in the early days, especially. I feel like as a human being, I have a more important role than an artist in that kind of situation. And I started asking people to write their accounts. And I presented the first version of what I called the Tahrir stories. And at the very end, we read the names of people who died in those days. It was just some amazing stories of beauty and courage and people finding their voice for the first time.
We only progress through evolution. Revolution is important to slap us in the face, to help you realize that you need to pause and rethink where you are as a humanity so that you can develop.
I am also a farmer, and I know that you need to plant a lot of seeds for things to grow. And many of the things I'm growing now, I will not reap the fruit of because they will take a long time, maybe way past my lifetime. And this is the same with the change and the big changes and the revolution. We are planting seeds now that will bear fruit later. So I continue to do what I believe is important, which is to connect to people and to take care of the planet. And taking care of the planet gives me some sanity. It's really hard to be depressed when you're next to trees because regardless of what's going on, they have life force and they bloom and they become amazing and lush, and you try to stay depressed, but it's really not that easy.
Wow. So you can understand the power and importance of Dalia's work in this world. And of course, her tremendous smile that shines light whenever it's received. Next, I have the opportunity of introducing the legendary Will Calhoun. Will Calhoun is a musical shaman and a graduate of Berklee College of Music, where recently he received his degree in recording and engineering, as well as recently he received the Alumni Lifetime Achievement Award in 2019. Will is also a two-time Grammy winner and a four-time nominee with the genre-bending iconic rock band Living Color, and produced Herb Albert's Color CD and Most Def's Black Jack Johnson Project. Will has invested over 25 years of personal research in Mali, Morocco, Senegal, the outback of Australia, Belize, and northern Brazil to document and study the true history of drums, rhythm, sonic vibrations, and their impact on modern music. He is also an inventor and an avid user of technology and promotes its unique role in creating music. Let's experience his work.
Will Calhoun, world explorer, artistic time traveler, and of course, rock legend. Not many artists have the vision and artistic energy to be Grammy Award winners and contribute to so many genres, everything from jazz to hip-hop. Your musical repertoire spans nearly four decades, sharing your unique mastery of technology and artistry with an eclectic and inspiring cast of artists that span everyone from B.B. King to Carly Simon to the Rolling Stones to Mos Def. A Brooklyn native, you arrived at Berkeley in the fall of 1982. Bright-eyed and ready to refine your craft, you would discover the world of music production and engineering, and would forever be changed as you would see how technology could give your artistry limitless possibility. Upon leaving Berkeley, your star would only rise higher and shine brighter. You would team up with the now legendary band Living Color. It was there that your art and power as a world-class musician would take flight. By the early 1990s, Living Color had attained worldwide success and earned accolades for their hit song, Cult of Personality, which won the Grammy Award for Best Hard Rock Performance and earned the band its second Grammy.
The first time I met Will was when Living Color would open for my shows at the Ritz in New York. And they were the young guns of New York. They were reshaping the musical scene. And Will was one of the drummers who, if you were looking at that area, you had to definitely look at him.
As a megastar in a wildly popular band, your travels opened your mind and craft to learning new styles and researching the world's historical, rhythmic, and cultural foundations. You have often referred to yourself as an eternal student of all things musical and magical. As a modern-day sound conjurer, you have melded art and technology to create a highly contemporary vision for what the drummer of tomorrow can be, bringing the drummer from the back of the stage to front and center.
To me, for a legacy from Will, which I don't think he's finished building yet, it is really the ability to take all these disparate elements and turn them into something that speaks to other people.
Will Calhoun, for your ability to connect a generation of listeners to the drumming arts, for your exploration and curiosity to explore rhythms and cultures of the past, for your vision to see music and sound as a bridge between the rhythms of our forefathers and the better side of our future selves, and for your contributions that would forever change the musical landscape. We recognize your achievement.
If you were like me, you're bobbing your head to the beats of the great Will Calhoun. And we certainly look forward to having conversations with him very shortly. Now I have the privilege, honor, and pleasure of introducing Guatemala's Dr. Nativo, a name doctor that was given to his grandfather, that he carries on that ancestral tradition. Dr. Nativo is one of Central America's most exciting new talents. His music layer Mayan spirituality, social activism, and folk wisdom over a propulsive sound combining reggae, cumbia, hip-hop, and pre-Columbian instruments. His debut album, Guatemala, a name he prefers to call Guatemala, in honor of the ancestral roots of the spirituality and profound nature of the Mayan culture. His album calls for social justice for his country's indigenous majority. Dr. Nativo, at a young age, dedicated his life to music, busting his way through Europe, India, and Latin America before landing in Cuba to study at the National School of the Arts in Havana. Eventually, he settled in Barcelona, where he played music in the streets and mastered the art through direct contact with the people, always people-centered. His second studio album, La Cocina del Dr. Nativo, is set for release in the fall of 2021. I watched him and was immediately pulled into his spirit. Please enjoy.
No queremos más política genocida. Ay, no, 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 no. No queremos más de que nos maten, que nos callen, que nos den pa' abajo, mami, que el hijo eso no queremos. El hijo eso no queremos. El hijo eso no queremos. El hijo eso no.
Wow. Once again, we understand why Dr. Nativo's music would resonate anywhere in the world. The beat, particularly for someone who's from Detroit, with Motown and of course hip hop roots and rap roots, just the whole conglomeration of his sounds and the spiritual basis was compelling. We now, actually speaking of Detroit, are now get very rooted with Salakastar. Salakastar, a Detroit-born and based actor, singer, songwriter, poet, and teaching artist working in theater, television, film, and music. So we see here the expansiveness of her creativity, and that cuts across all the artists we have introduced today. They cannot be defined. They are evolving their own spiritual essence to freedom. She earned her BFA and completed her classical acting training at the State University of New York at Purchase College. She is an ensemble member of a host of people, a member of the touring company, I Too Sing America at the Michigan Opera Theater, and a founding member of Three Sisters, that's Three Small Eyes Sisters, a Detroit-based feminist writing ensemble. This dynamic sister is a 2018 Gilda Award winner and a 2020 Kresge Arts Fellow in Live Arts, the first time having that award combined. Her debut album, All Blue, Part One, Majoriel, will be released independently through her label, Salakastar Studios, in 2021. Outside of her professional artistic practice, you will see she loves fashion, spending time with her cat, listening to records, and being an auntie and making delicious vegan meals. Please sit back and enjoy. And again, I respond with your applause via social media.
Dans ce lieu qu'elle disait sien, la vérité qu'elle chanta était pénible pour certains. Se sont bouchées les oreilles dans ce lieu qu'elle disait sien. La vérité qu'elle chanta n'a pas été comprise par tous. Ils ont donc bouché leurs oreilles, dit que son chant n'était pas beau. Elle est partie, n'a rien dit pendant 7 étés, 28 saisons, pas un mot. Elle médita, se concentra et rumina sur le bleu. À la 29e saison, elle entrouvit les cuisses et un rayon bleu en surgit. Ils se sont tous mis à vibrer. Majorelle, Majorelle. Elle ouvrit les yeux et un rayon bleu en surgit. Ils se sont tous mis à vibrer. Majorelle, Majorelle. Elle ouvrit la bouche et une fleur en surgit. Ils se sont tous mis à vibrer. Majorelle, Majorelle.
She opened up her thighs and forth sprang a blue light. They all began to sprang
simply magical. Tonight, you see that we have brought together some world-class artists, artists who have suffered through the COVID-19, not being able to express themselves fully. So we're gonna focus on the theme, what is democracy? And I like to pose that question to all the artists, what is democracy? And what are the foundational elements that make a democracy? I'd like to be very expansive in your ideas. I asked a question openly to all the panels. Please respond. Let's start with Dalia.
I was hoping to go last, but hello, good morning. It's 1 a.m. in Cairo, we're outside of Cairo where I am right now. And when I think about democracy, my ideas go directly to the idea of equality, having your voice heard, balance in society, equanimity. So it's not just the political, but also the fair access to whatever it is, like not just goods or services, but maybe even internet, which is a way for us to live our lives right now because of COVID. So who has access to what, and who is denied access, whether it's to knowledge or to resources? Because I believe that the planet has enough to sustain us if we honor the planet and if we share the resources well with not just our fellow humans, but with the other creatures on it. So how do we do that? I think democracy is a way to do that, but also it's the way of being, or trying to find that balance between our needs and our demands.
Dr. Nativo.
Good afternoon, everybody. Well, I don't be the most indicated person to answer this question of democracy, because I believe before there is a democracy, there has to be a human respect and many other things. And like the ideal of democracy is a system that is for the people, by the people. So I don't think, in my point of view, that is something that can be conceived totally in these times. Yes.
Yes. First of all, thank you so much for inviting me here. I'm just blown away by the level of talent and wisdom that is in this space right now. And I'm so inspired by everyone here. Democracy. That's a loaded term. I feel like I've been taught as an American person that democracy is a very American idea. It's an idea of equality. It's an idea of everyone having a voice and everyone's voices being equal. But those things are complicated, right? Because those ideas aren't necessarily true. And I think I'm learning that more and more every day, especially in the past 4 years. And I think my relationship to not only democracy, but my relationship to Americanness as a Black American and specifically as a descendant of enslaved people, it's complicated. I think that the most important aspects of a democracy are freedom to create art and also freedom of the press and also the press's commitment to the truth.
Excellent. And I will have to say that in posing a question, I personally question if a democracy ever existed in the United States. However, I'd like to hear, Will, your perspective on what is democracy and what are the foundational elements that consist of a democracy. Yeah.
Can you hear me now? I'm sorry.
Yes.
I was trying to respectfully keep my mic muted. First of all, I'd like to thank everyone at the Arab American Museum, Charles, and the fantastic panelists. It's great to be on this panel with everyone and to see what everybody's doing. It's beautiful to see the work everybody's doing, and especially in these challenging times. Technically, democracy to me is the practice or principles of equality as a definition. I look at it that way. And the second part of your question, the foundation elements are the necessary things you need to make that happen. If I think about music, I think of jazz as a democracy in terms of people coming to the table to contribute to a style of music that improvises. People's personalities come into the music. People's ideas come into the music. You know, sometimes they work, sometimes they don't. As accustomed to maybe playing in a classical situation where you play, and maybe if you play the wrong note or it's not swinging or it's not straight, somebody in the orchestra may look at you a certain kind of a way. So the best example is in the art form is maybe the form of jazz and even some forms of indigenous music. How it plays out in the realm of human beings in life is different. You have a lot of things that are defined. You have a definition of what freedom is. And it may not be the same thing for all people. Just freedom's a word that we use and somebody wants to be free. We can look at Haiti and say, what does that mean? As an example. So that's what the definition of democracy means to me. The foundation principles are what we are going to put into it to work for us. We are the people on this panel that are standing on the shoulders of great, great people who allow us to continue a certain kind of conversation. And the changes and the structures and the reality begins there and what we're going to do about our situation. And the definition is the definition. And we have to decide on as artists or individuals how we want to make democracy work for us or not. Although the definition exists, and you may say there isn't one in a sense, but what are we going to do? I'll speak for myself. What am I going to do about the situation in that term in my life and in my art? And I just try to group myself with people who are on the same page that I am, and we can make the changes we have to make. We can present it. That's what the fun about being, one of the fun aspects of being in a great band like Living Color is we talk about it in our music. You can look at the videos, you know, songs like Funny Vibe, where we just talk about experiences of getting on elevators and having people clutch their bags. Or people asking us, why are we playing rock and roll when Black people invented rock and roll? So I like to put the democracy concept and the foundational aspects, as you stated, into my art. I'm not expecting everyone to agree with it, but if it's going to be about equality, then we should all be able to have a conversation at the table.
Well great. So we want to continue to expand on a focus on democracy. And I asked each of you to respond to what a democracy look like if it was run by artists. Dr. Nativo.
All right. So from my point of view, I think the ideal system, you can say, if you want to call it democracy, it would have to be led by many different talent people. It should be not just artists, but also psychics, scientifics. It would have to be a big team, from my perspective. But yeah, I think artists are very, very, very essential. in this game, if you want to call it like that. And it's important that we get the right recognition as artists in all the different aspects of a system.
I'm just going to jump in here. I think that a democracy led by artists would look like my rehearsal room, right? I do devise theater with a company here in Detroit called A Host of People. And what we do is we come in with a subject and a vision, and we figure out the most imaginative ways to execute that vision on a very small budget. And we come together, people from different backgrounds, to create really beautiful art, thought-provoking art. So I think democracy led by artists, I think we would get things done, because we do. At the end of the day, the show goes on. And also just being able to use our imaginations, I think would be helpful in a democracy.
Yes.
My experience is a little bit jaded, because over the past few years in Egypt, at least, many artists who claim to be revolutionary were actually working against the revolution. And only the artists who were produced or seen or given a space on stage or on the air were mainly implementing some form of an agenda for somebody else. So many of the true artists are hiding or finding other things to do or completely silent. So I feel like we need to level the playing field before we say artists, and which artist or who can do it, that we can have a real democracy before we think about the democracy run by artists, so that we can have more of a cacophony of voices, not just the one tone that is heard in many places. Sometimes it's through the funding, and we've seen this in lots of other countries. Who gets the money, which voice is the one that is sponsored or supported, which vision is the one that is put center stage or in the mainstream. So I feel like that needs to be addressed first. And then when we have the range of voices, we can ask these voices to be the council that leads democracy.
I'm going to chime in here. I agree with Dalia 100%. It's very well stated. It has to get down to, I guess, when you talk about artists, who the artists are, but not trying to get political. I think if artists in the right mindset were to be in charge of a democracy, it would look like the freedom of expression. As artists, we would be able to express ourselves freely, dance, or politically, in terms of gender, in terms of race. It's just how we flow as artists, how we go around the world, how we create what inspires us. Everybody's video and comments already inspired me just from watching at the top of the show. So I think on a generic playing field as artists, before you get into funding and politics of it, I like to think that if it's run by artists, it'd be a total freedom of expression. And I think we have examples. I have examples from my influences, like a Charlie Parker, Jimi Hendrix. I think artists like that were not concerned with genres and people and crowds and money. They were more dealing conceptually what was going on inside of them. John Coltrane, Miles Davis, these kind of artists. So I like to think that as an artist, on the general statement of being an artist and thinking like an artist and existing like an artist before politics and money and foundations and those kind of things, it would be an example of freedom of expression. I don't know everybody on this panel, but I'd like to think, just from watching videos, if we were all sit down and discuss how we want to create something, I think it would be pretty universal and fair just from everyone's vibe, but that's just my feeling.
Well, you know, in my discussions with each of you, I talked about one of the central elements of freedom, that in order to be an artist, you have to have freedom to create your own vision. You certainly need resources, but you cannot be dictated to play this note, use this paint, use this actress. You have to kind of move in that spirit of freedom of expression, will, as you so rightly stated, and as expressed through all of your work. Does anyone have any additional comments? And again, to the listening audience, we ask that you use social media to send in questions. So we will add your questions. This is participatory. This is a democratic process so that we all can learn, be inspired, and grow from this discussion. Does anyone have any further comments on the panel? So I have another question, which is in line with a previous comment about democracy. Because one might argue that a true democracy cannot exist in a country which has caused genocide of indigenous nations, the enslavement and continuing oppression of African descendants, the perpetuation of apartheid laws, mass incarceration, and the privatization of prisons, the subjugation of women, and the historical and ongoing, even to this day, suppression of Black and Brown people's voting rights. I'd like each of you to answer, do you agree or disagree with the statement? And how does your creative work address any of these issues?
Well, for me, as artists, you know, we have to combat those things. You can look at what you said a couple ways. One of the ways could be the reality of what's happening in many countries around the world with the things that you stated. That's one aspect of it. As an artist, for me, it's my artistic endeavor and my colleagues to challenge and combat those very things that you mentioned. That's my way of dealing with it, is to partner with people who are on the same page to challenge those things. I look at my art as not how it exists. It exists in me, and that's enough. And it was my job is to get what exists in me to get out and let people like it or not like it. You're not correct about those things that you stated, but I kind of want to get on the solution side of things and deal with those kind of things and confront them. As artists, that's what we do. We confront those kind of things. Those positions are set up and arranged. Some of them are hundreds and some of them even thousands of years old. As an artist, I have to ask myself, how do I want to combat it? The things that I disagree with, things that I don't like, what's my role, who can I link up with to approach the voting rights scenario, or to approach slavery, or to approach what happened in Congo or what's happening in Haiti. Those are the kind of things that, as artists, for me, I like to just hook up, link up with people and approach those topics. I don't think about it in a way so much as whether I think it's a democracy or not, because if I sit around wasting time wondering what it is, I'm missing out on playing defense. And I'm a sports junkie. And I played semi-professional sports here in New York as a youth, with the very good basketball leagues like the Gauchos and some of the leagues here in the Bronx and in Harlem. And our coach used to always tell us, defense wins games. He used to always tell us that, defense wins games. And I use that as a motto in my art and my life. And playing defense doesn't mean you have to be, it doesn't always mean war and revenge. But defense is strategy. Something is coming at you and you have to decide on how you're going to defend it, meaning stop it from happening so you can get to the things that you want to get to. And that's basically how I look at the things that you just mentioned. They're horrifying, and more horrifying things are going to come as far as what's our planet.
Salakastar?
I really agree with everything you just said, Will. And do I think that a true democracy can exist with those things? No. but that is always, and again, I'm speaking from a Black American perspective, those things have always been present in our reality, but we've always used art to resist those things, to fortify ourselves, to heal ourselves, right? When my people came here, we came here with nothing. We were brought here, forced here with nothing. The only thing we really had is our songs, our stories, and our rhythms. And to be able to continue that tradition with my own music and with my own poetry and theater is really important, because art, music has always been healing for me, and it has always been a way for me to carry on within those realities. And it's always been an opportunity to share and to do the necessary healing that needs to take place when we're dealing with all of those realities that you mentioned.
You know, the word that you kept using resonates the concept of healing, which I consider to be at the central heart of each of your work, that there is a spiritual dimension. As when I talked with you, Dalia, you talked about the role of the feminine divine. So I would like you to continue along that line of thought in terms of, if you can speak about that, Dalia, the role of women and how that plays in your work. And I'd like each of you to talk about women as a central force within your work, which counters kind of a male-dominated society to make society more democratic. And I'll just reference the fact, Dr. Nativo, you talk about your wife playing in your band and the use of women. But can we talk about that for a moment? And also, I'm going to invite the listening audience to pose questions in our social media chat. Dalia?
I love what Will and Salakastar said, and I agree, because they are really tapping into that question of democracy from the artistic perspective. And the image I had as they were talking is that somebody's being suffocated with a pillow over their face. They cannot really breathe. They're fighting for their life. It's really, really hard when you're under complete oppression to be able to practice democracy or anything, I suppose. And it feels like art is that breathing space that gives us this, like, lifting that pillow or whatever it is that is completely controlling us, to be able to breathe a little bit, or even to push that, to have a breathing room, to have space to create or to move. Or so the art becomes the way to democracy as well. It's freeing us from oppression, or finding a way around things, or finding a way around censorship. I mockingly, in a panel many years ago, spoke about what I dream of for theater in Egypt, saying that I presented a play where women were not hurt or beaten or gone crazy or slapped or were forced to get married, and the censorship did not oppose. And not many people in the audience got the joke. It seemed to me that most of the plays, not just in Egypt, but in many of the the places where I watched theater or I studied or practiced, many of the plays have marginalized women completely. They don't even have a name in lots of movies. And if you have a character, she's either the Gertrude or the Ophelia, the completely innocent one, or the one described as the bitch or something. So it's a fascinating way of how women are placed in most of the literature. And that just tells us about a lot, the work that we really need to continue to work by shedding light on work by women, or work that supports the balance, and looking at previous works that existed and were very prominent in their time, but we don't hear about them in history anymore, and supporting the work of people now, people of different backgrounds, different skin colors, gender, just allowing that room for space, room and space for the diversity. I mean, the title of our conversation is The Concert of Colors, and the range is not just the concert as in the music concert, but also the gathering together. So I'm just starting the conversation with women, but we can talk a lot longer. I'd love to hear from my colleagues as well, and I can step in again.
Okay. That's very nice. Yes. Dalia. Women playing a role. Well, I'll just cut to the chase. You know, women are the strongest. Is the strongest example of a human being I've ever met. I'll just start with that. I used to tell my teachers in second and third grade when we were debating the picture of Jesus. I went to religious schools, which probably was a mistake for me, but they had a picture of Jesus painted on the wall. In second grade, I went to Lutheran school, and I told my teacher, you know, Jesus Christ is black, right? My teacher was like, why is that an issue? And I said, if it's not an issue, then take that one down. But I'm saying that to say, my teacher then asked me, I said, well, somebody painted that. That's a painting. It's somebody's idea. And then my teacher asked me, if someone asked you to paint Jesus Christ, who would you paint? I said, I paint my mom. You know, I paint her up. That would be, her face would be up there. So, you know, that's the kind of thing I think about. I think no struggle is possible or successful without women. Unfortunately, we've had probably too many where women play back roles too. And a lot of the struggles, that's why they were unsuccessful. That's just my opinion. They were limited to certain kinds of roles. But I will move that over to being a drummer. And my favorite instrument is the udu drum. It's spelled UDU. It's a Nigerian clay drum. That's feminine energy. It's the water in your body to make it move. And that's the instrument that I actually enjoy playing the most. And whenever I play that instrument live, it gets the most reaction from a crowd, whether it's young DJ kids or I'm playing for even a symphony audience. So it's important, I think, knowing that the oldest known a skull found is a woman's skull so far, at least the scientists, you know, so we know to give birth, we know what that kind of means. And being a musician and being a rhythmatist, you know, you understand energy. The women's vibration is different from the males, and the females has different kind of vibrations. And the feminine vibrations actually give birth to other rhythms. It gives birth to other sounds and kind of other ideas a bit more than the males do. And most indigenous drummers that I study with have given me that information to make sure that I'm aware of that and I pay attention to it and I don't ignore it. So what role does it play for me? Massive role. My grandmother, my mom, my neighbors, I have an older sister, you know, I have a daughter. So all of those kind of those lineages of women for me is very, very, very powerful. And I am very fortunate to have experienced the advice and the reality of all of those women never pulling my leg, always just being direct and being honest about things. And I would have to say 95% of the things I solved in my life or I dealt with was based on information from some women or another, a family member or something, to help me to look at it a different way and to get kind of broader perspective on it without it. Women have to deal with another kind of frequency, just being women in the world. They have another whole doctrine of defense, sometimes homogenizing their nature, or putting them in the kind of second class citizen kind of a vibe. So when that happens to you, you have a different intake on information and how to live or successfully overcome those kind of things. So being a person that loves to do research, for me, women are extremely informative. So for my struggles and for my art, for my music, for my songwriting, and everything that I do, I try to keep a vibe in it with colors that I like to wear, or something I'm putting in the garden, you know, flowers growing or vegetables that you grow, or beat that I play. I always try to make sure that the feminine vibe and the energy is in the mix. And it's gotten me this far, so it can't be too bad.
you like to add to the conversation, Dr. Nativo?
Yes, I also agree with all the rest of the panelists in their points of view. I think from my perspective, it's very important that we understand we've been ruled by the patriarch. By the patriarch rules, you know, for hundreds of years, and it's not been working. We can start by the calendar we use. Is a masculine energy calendar based? It's based on the sun. So if we could reconnect with the ancestral calendars that are actually based on the moon, which is feminine energy, we could actually get back into the natural rhythms of living, because definitely is time to empower the feminine aspect, and the female has to be definitely the person in power in these moments. And with the adding to what you said, like you comment that I use my wife in the band, I think it would be better to say that she is a very important component in this band. And also we can add, it's not just her, it's also a neighbor, say, which is a Afro-American violin player. And also the percussionist is from Puerto Rico, Jenny Delgado. So we're only two men in the band. Three female, two men. So it's time to that balance to come up to, like, you know, it's been too much male. Now it has to be more female in order to this be the counterpart, I think. And regarding how my art, at least, or our art, addressing this oppression and racism and all of that. My music, the lyrics in my songs, they talk about everything that I've seen and I've experienced. So definitely you can hear it through the lyrics. For example, Minorías, the song that was in the beginning of the panel. Thank you. Coming from Living Color, that's a great honor. It's that song is actually a tribute to Claudia Gomez, which is a young woman that came, you can say, as an illegal to this country. She's actually from a town very close to my town in Quetzaltenango. And she came here to hopefully work and save enough money to go back home and pay for her university studies. And she was in a park in 2018. And she was in a park with other illegal people, and a ranger from Texas saw her and saw that she was a little bit scared and shoot her in the head. And kill her. So for her, the American dream became the American nightmare. And this is just one case of millions of cases, you know. So it's important that, for me, I always encourage artists to have a content that matters in their music. We have such a big power with our words and with our being, that it's important that we are conscious of what we are saying, what we are proposing, because it's not protest, it's proposals. We're proposing solutions, you know. So it's important to give the space like this. I'm very also grateful for this moment to be able to express and share with all the rest of the panelists.
Yeah, I'm also very, very thankful to be have this conversation with artists, because all too often we don't have the opportunity to go inside the mind of artists, to listen to what they have to say as spiritual beings. As each of you know, I opened up a pathway to getting to know you by asking you about your grandparents, because I truly believe that your grandparents are in you, that their grandparents are in you. And Dalia and I talked about the fact that if you follow that logic of what's in your DNA, that you're very ancient, that you've been here forever, that you carry a very important tradition, that the work you do is very sacred and very spiritual. And that's why we want to listen to you as voices of what would a democratic society look like, because at heart, you're visionaries. Now, I want to take a moment to acknowledge the democratic process of entreating the audience to ask questions. And we have received a question that I'd like to pose to you. You are all located in different parts of the world, or from different parts of the world. How does your work promote global solidarity between communities? How does your work promote global solidarity?
I'll try to answer this question. So I'm located in Detroit, and if we talk about the influence that Detroit has on music worldwide, it's huge. And I'm so honored to be making music here, to be in community with artists here, and specifically to be in community and making work with Black women who are focused on healing. I'll kind of backtrack to the last question about talking about the feminine divine. You know, there is an overabundance of toxic masculinity. So in order to combat that, it is important to bring in the divine feminine. And that is not limited to gender. I think everyone, every being will benefit from allowing that divine feminine in, especially in the ways that we treat the earth. We see the ways that toxic masculinity, we see the consequences as the earth is getting hotter. We see how that toxic masculinity and how that patriarchy is affecting the earth. And I think making work here, making healing work, I hope that healing energy expands to everyone who participates and listens to my work. And I hope to share those experiences of healing with global communities.
Dalia?
I love what you said, and from my perspective, I want to say what's happening for me and around me, it's not enough. I would love to be able to connect more, that often is connected to more freedom of expression, but also freedom of movement sometimes. When you're in a festival and you meet other artists from other parts of the world, and then conversations become richer and deeper, even just by sharing a word in your culture, or if you're jamming with different music and different musicians from different places and creating that kind of solidarity. Where I am now, this is not allowed. And I think all over the world, because of COVID and its aftermath, I think it's more limited than what I would like for it to be or to happen. So I feel that the true ambassadors are the artists and the language of art, whether it's music, painting, theater, song, poetry, dance, is the universal language that eventually should be uniting us as humans. And more needs to happen from my perspective for that solidarity.
Will?
Hey, Charles, just for clarity, can you just rephrase the question for me a bit, please?
Sure. The question from the global community, you're located in different parts of the world. How does your work promote global solidarity between communities?
Okay. How is by just acknowledging other works from other countries and other cultures, acknowledging the language, acknowledging the food, acknowledging the influences. I personally love it. I love traveling. I love learning about other. I mean, being a drummer, it was just fun to go to Morocco to play with the Ganawa musicians, and to go to the northern parts of Brazil and study maracatu, which, coming from New York, I thought maracatu was Brazilian and maracatu from Angola. So when I went to study with God, like, this is the whole thing. And my role that I enjoy doing is taking these things that I've studied and sharing them. That's the most important thing. It doesn't belong to me. I share it. I put a Nigerian piece in with a Haitian piece. And I'm from the Bronx, put the Bronx thing on top of that. And the idea is, that's the most interesting art for me, is when it combines different elements. So promoting it is respecting other people's cultures and other people's languages and lifestyles and music, and not being afraid to stick out your hand and go study, and when you get the information, share it. That's what I think is the biggest part. If you're painting, if you're dancing, if you're doing poetry, share it. Somebody in that audience may be from that country. You may turn somebody on to something that they never heard before. You never know what the reaction is going to be in terms of positivity and democracy, and having people really start to understand each other, because a lot of walls go up due to ignorance and misunderstandings and assimilations and assumptions too. So this is a part that I think, if I had to use one word to answer that question, it would be sharing. Is the way you promote it, is you let people know that it's okay. We're living cuz rock band, but we play, we throw in metal, we throw in Bob Marley, we throw in we cover songs. People are always shocked, because we'll cover the Stones, we'll cover Bowie, we'll cover Bob Marley, we'll cover the Jackson 5. It's all great music. It's all things that we listen to and we like that turned us on. So why not share it? Why do we have to go into a venue and say we're only going to cover rock tunes? It's music. It's what people. Bob Marley's a perfect example. Everyone likes Bob Marley's music. Everyone likes James Brown's music. Everyone that I've met, anyway, it's hard for you. Your most stiffest grandparent or conservative relative could sit there with the suit on, with an attitude. You put James Brown on, somebody's foot is going to start tapping. It's automatic. It's infectious. And that's the idea.
Fantastic.
Yes, I also agree. Like, sharing is caring, like they say. And for example, in my case, right now I'm on a mission. I don't like to call it a tour more than I like to call it a mission. And I'm not in my home, in my Guatemala, as I call it, because Guate is not mala. Mala means bad. So we change it to Guatemala, as the more powerful and more rooted connotation. And For example, right now I am here in the United States going, doing, of course, a few shows, whatever is possible now with all the restrictions, and also going to universities and colleges and schools, and sharing is the most important thing. So we are, for example, we just went to North Carolina to the Live Global Arts program, and we went to give this workshop of Mayan tradition and Mayan calendar to kids of from 5 years old to 8 years old. And they are in North Carolina, in a place where most of them haven't even left their little town. So it's so beautiful to see how they get into the Mayan animal spirits and how they learn about all of this connectivity with Mother Earth. So I think it's very important that we focus our work as artists also in the youth, in being able to share these ancient traditions with the youth. They are gonna be the ones that are gonna actually make the changes in this world.
So I'd like to pose another question to each of you. And, you know, I'm just going to call for a moment of reflection. What impact do you hope your creative work has on society? What impact do you hope your creative work has on society? Please.
Okay, I'm going first this time. Well, I have witnessed the impact that our art and our creative work has on the society. In 2012, me and a couple of fellow musicians started a hip hop Cosmovision school in this region of Guatemala called Lake Atitlan, where a lot of indigenous kids are being treated as modern slaves because they only are in the streets carrying the baggages of tourists that come and working for these tourists. So with this school, we give them an outlet to be able to, one, rest from that character of the slave, and second, to through hip hop, that is something relatively modern, give them the hook to get hooked on rapping, breakdancing, and also going back to their native tongues, being proud of being indigenous, connecting with their ancestral calendars. So I witnessed how we started that, and a big percentage of these kids are now great musicians, are great basketball players. They are, it's since 2012, so it's been a while already. So I witnessed the impact of the work that we do, and it's important that we continue, all of us artists, on influencing the youth again.
Yeah, I'll go next. The other day I was listening to Minnie Riperton's Perfect Angel. I have it on vinyl. It's one of my most treasured possessions. I was listening to it, and I think that I've been listening to that record since before I was actually born. And I was listening to it, I had a pretty intense day, and I was just crying. And I was like, this record is saving my life right now. And I think if my work could just do that for one person, then I'd be okay.
Sorry, Mike. I'm just going to go and say positive effect. I'll share one story with everybody. Back in, I'm going to show my age now. Back when we first started touring, 1988, 89, you know, there wasn't all of this internet stuff. We actually had P.O. boxes, and we received letters from fans. And the most powerful letter Living Color ever received was from a young white youth in the South who said he was in the commissary, he was in prison. And he was watching the video channel, MTV at that time, and he saw our video. And he said, I was raised to hate black people. and I love rock and roll. And it was written in pencils, handwritten, it's a very interesting letter. And he said, when I saw this, you guys playing it, I had a confrontation within myself because I liked what I was hearing, but I was taught not to like what I was seeing. So I was doing battle with my own self. And he honestly said at the end of the letter, I don't know if I'm gonna change. I don't know if this music is something I'm gonna listen to again. But the video and the music made me stop to think that I have to think about changing. I got to think about life in a different way. That's kind of a small thing in a lot of things that happened to Live in Color, but it was a big thing for us because when you make music or not, you don't necessarily think about it being on that kind of level. You're just expressing yourself. He was a kid who grew up skinhead. He was a skinhead in prison. He admitted that. And he said that, that he had to stop and think about all the things his parents taught him and his neighborhood where he grew up, just based on that video. So I'll just quickly say positive is the impact you want to have, positive. Even if that young man never decided to change, the music gave him something to think about and it gave him an opportunity to think about himself and what he was doing. Maybe he changed in another way. We never heard from him again, but it was a powerful letter to receive at that point in the band's career.
I would love to dovetail on what Will said and think about positive change and affecting others. And the idea of thinking about a position, even if you don't change your position, at least you get the chance to question yourself. And I throw a lot of ideas in the plays I write. And sometimes I don't really elaborate on everything. It's like scattering seeds in the ground. And it's a metaphor I use because I plant a lot, but I also plant seeds in the writing a lot. And even when I'm teaching, and you can only put the seeds and water it. And what happens after that is really not in your hands. It's lots of other elements. And if the soil is ready or fertile, or if it gets too dry. And some of the seeds you plant might not really sprout immediately, and sometimes they surprise you later. I get letters way later than I expect, and it's kind of affirming to see that the aha moments when they happen to people after they watch something or they read something, and then they reflect on it, and then it resonates, and then it affects them, and then they write to me. So I've only gotten the letters, but 5 years later or 6 years later. To give people the chance to consider their position on something and to inspire them, that would be my hope and what I work for, and be very happy when it happens.
Charles, can I just add one more thing? I just want Absolutely. To say this to everybody.
Absolutely.
One of them, I was really fortunate to have a conversation, a long one, with the great, late great B.B. King. And one of the things, you know, B.B.'s like going to see, at the time, B.B.'s like going to see your grandfather, your uncle that knows everything. You have to just sit down and listen. And B.B. said, young man, never put out any art you don't believe or that's real. Because you might tell a lie with your art one day, and everybody might believe it, and you might have to spend the rest of your life telling a lie. The lie might be the thing that makes you popular amongst everyone, but you not really feel that. And he just wanted me to know, always do what honestly how you feel. Put into the art what you feel and express yourself to the fullest, because you don't know the impact. But he said, don't put the false stuff out there, because it just may be the thing everybody said knows you from, and they may love it, and you have to go around doing that. So I thought that was a powerful piece of advice early in my career. And I always think about BB when I'm going into the recording studio or I'm creating something. I kind of hear that voice of honesty and reality is what are the two really important. That's the salt and pepper, you know, on that meal. That's the very important seasoning on that meal. I just wanted to add that because Dalia made me think about it when she said that word. She made me think about what, you know, BB's conversation. And he said it in a way, in a disciplinary form. He wasn't saying it in a casual conversation. It was very heavy. And his look on his face was very heavy because obviously he was telling me something that he experienced. So I still to this day heed that information, and I just wanted to share that with the panelists.
Yeah, because all of you are dealing with the concept of bringing forth truth. And that's why artists are feared all over the world and why we embrace you. I want to mention that the founder of Council of Colors, Ishmael Ahmed, who received the Global Fest Visionary Award and was nominated for the Council of Arts, founded Council of Colors in 1992 in response to a police killing in Detroit of Malice Green. And the idea is that you focus on bringing people together through music, and you honor people of various diverse backgrounds. His radio show on WDTE is called Island Earth. So I wanted to reference and to talk about, and just one quick second, Will, your reference to someone who communicated to you from prison. There is a work, Prison Writings, Prison Writings by Leonard Peltier, a United States prisoner from the Native American community. And he has a poem called We Are Not Separate. We are not separate. We are not separate beings, you and I. We are different strands of the same being. You are me, and I am you. And we are they, and they are us. This is how we're meant to be. Each of us one. Each of us all. You reach out across the void of otherness to me, and you touch your own soul. That's what your work represents, and why we honor the Arab American National Museum for, in this critical time of change, that we have to be centered by going and looking at the world through the lens of our artists and celebrating you. And that's what this is tonight, a celebration of each of you, your light, your humanity, your work, and we wish you continued strength, fearlessness, vision, and perpetuation in the further evolution of who you are. So on behalf of the Arab American National Museum and on behalf of the world, we thank you as we still battle against COVID and injustice. You are our best hope for the future. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. In Mayan is in La Kesh. I'm another you. I'm another you. In La Kesh.
I want to say thanks. Sorry, Dalia. Go ahead. Sorry, please. Go ahead.
Just thanking all of you, and it's an honor to share space with all of you, and I hold that space sacred in my heart. Thank you.
I just want to say, Charles, can you please also put everyone's contact information, send it to us. I would like to support everyone's work and see what everyone's doing. You know, Doctor, that was a cold tune, man. I was digging that tune. That was a cold piece. We gotta get back to that, man. You gotta get some drums on there. You gotta get some Bronx on there. But we'll talk about that after. That's a cold piece. Very nice music, beautiful music. But I'd like to support everyone, whether they're doing stuff online or Dolly, you have plays, I could turn other people on to your art. I'd like to share. So just Charles, in some way, just get the contact or the emails or the Instagrams. And if anyone's doing anything, no matter where I am, I'd love to support it and turn my family, my musical family, onto what everyone's doing. Because what everyone's doing, I think, is fantastic. So thanks for the opportunity, Charles. It's lovely to meet everyone. And good luck with everything that we are looking forward to getting to in these challenging times.
And we encourage everyone to continue to watch Concert of Colors. These are tremendous artists that are bringing forth wonderful magic. So continue to watch Concert of Colors, continue to support the arts, and continue to support these artists. Have a great evening.
A desconectar de su demencia y voy a desconectarlo de este sistema.